every time it makes me nervous.
There it is, the jump and thing.
You landed in a space about this
one. Yeah, I got real nervous when I looked
at it. That's on us, though. That was bad chair placement.
Bad chair placement. Yeah. And I had bad placement on the chair. I thought he was going to land on my head.
Yes. Yeah, and so did I.
That was like this, like, oh.
And I would have just like stopped once your head probably yeah. inserted into my butt, like.
It would have taken me out.
Yeah.
You would have been out. And you would have had a great panel.
The dick panel.
Hey, Chicago, usually Rich goes, you see our faces all weekend, da 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 da, and here's Matt Cohen. But, like, I kind of know you've seen Rich already, but you didn't see him yesterday, so I could be like, hey, who's that karaoke? Make some noise.
Woo!
See? We didn't need you at all.
I know.
Guys.
But I can say it. You've seen a lot of me.
That's right.
You haven't seen a lot of these two, Matt Cohen and Richard Smith Jr.
Yeah.
We're doing the green pants dance.
That's right. It's the
two green different green. Shades of green. Kind of the same, but different. One pair is on an old dude. The other pair is on Matt.
That's good. That
looks great.
It's kind of a before and after.
This is Matt going, and this is what happens if you don't take care of yourself. You become this guy. The pants get blousy, they fade.
And if you wash them a lot, then that's
the face gets effed up, you shrink a couple inches.
And you get a hat.
You get bald legged, and you have to wear a hat to cover up your toupee.
It's a great hat.
Thank you.
Well,
good start.
Remember when you guys both wore red pants and I got jealous that I didn't have red pants?
No, I don't remember that at all.
Sweet Jesus, that was the darkest day.
It was the old me. And I'd get sensitive about things like that. And I literally got mad. Nobody told me to be red pants. I was really immature then.
I actually, you said, as you're walking behind us, and Rich and I were walking in our red pants, Rob goes from behind us. He's like, but I don't get the invitation, apparently. So then I yelled at Robbie, because I'm also a very aggravated individual, and sometimes I explode on people.
It's the only fight Matt and I have ever gotten.
Ever.
Red pants gate.
And it was and we all came on to do a panel, and we were all three pissed for the entire panel.
Yeah.
And I remember we'd say, three, is it Rob's an asshole? Red pants make Rob an asshole. Three, is Rob's an asshole?
Yes, I am. I'm a real asshole. Yeah, that was a good song and a great moment.
Listen, just so you know, you brought it up.
I brought it up as a way to cleanse it, to tell you that I'm okay with it now.
Well, the only thing I've learned is that red pants make you angry, green pants don't.
There you go.
That's my takeaway.
Yeah.
Green pants are happy pants.
Happy
green pants. Stop, you're pissing
me off. When you're driving, green means go, and red means stop, and yellow means slow down. But if you're a banana, green means stop, yellow means go, and red means, where did you get that banana?
That's a Mitch Hedberg joke.
It is.
And if you're a pants, green means nice pants. Red means go fuck yourself, no one told me to wear red pants.
That's right. Somebody finally gets that.
By the way, that's a pretty good Mitch Hedberg imitation. Like, you even did it in the Mitch Hedberg. All right, let's take questions, shall we?
Let's do it.
Why not? Pretend to answer stuff, all right?
Hi, guys.
Hey.
Hi.
So, this question is for Matt.
Hello.
So, I've been watching General Hospital for years.
Oh, yes.
And when my mom started watching Supernatural 2, she's like, hey, it's that sexy doctor. So.
You know what? Thank your mom. She's a great lady.
So, I wanted to ask, what's it like being on a soap opera versus being on a drama like Supernatural?
It is just complete bipolar opposites. We do 100 pages of dialogue a day, Supernatural, a show like that does 7 to 10. 10 would be a massive day, right, Rich? Rob?
Yeah.
It's been so long.
I mean, yeah, you do about, you know,
8. 10 days a big day on...
10's huge. Like, 8.
Yeah, 8. 8's normal.
Yeah, this week coming back, I have this next week off, and then the following week I go back to work. I do 10 episodes in 5 days. So
if you try to figure that out, I'll do probably 250 to 300 pages of dialogue in 5 days.
Well, like, and how much, and how many pages? It's a ton.
It's a ridiculous amount. I mean,
how long is it, I guess, how long is a script? Like, one script would be...
One script is, like, probably 80 pages.
It's crazy. Yeah.
And then... And one script in Supernatural is about 42, 43?
Yeah, yeah. And then you get, like, you know, you walk in and you do like a dry blocking rehearsal where you're just in your normal clothes, you show up in the morning. The director's like, all right, listen, I need you to go over here on this line, grab that bottle of water, and then say your next line as you slide over here, you do that, you put the water down, you come over here, you say your next thing, and that's it. And then, okay, go put your clothes on, and then we shoot it. That's just like, that's all how it happened. To get like one take, and the motto is kind of, you know, if the camera doesn't fall over, it's going to end up on television, so...
Wait, you invented a new term in the beginning of that that maybe you've used before, but I'd never picked up on it. Bipolar opposites.
Yeah, bipolar opposites.
It's not just completely opposed imagery. It's emotionally different.
Yeah. Yes.
One is completely different and filled with emotional highs and lows. I guess. Yes. So congratulations.
Yeah. It's basically you're hanging on by a thread every minute of every day you're at work. That's sums up soap opera life for you.
Thank you for your question.
Thank you. Hi.
Over there.
I just want to thank Matt and Rob for making yesterday great.
Good job, boys.
But my question is for Richard.
Yes, ma'am. Oh, we see what you did there.
Yes. Well played.
How did you feel with the Gabriel storyline? Because I honestly felt a little gypped.
Apologies to the gypsies in the house. Well, here's the thing. I didn't, and I'll tell you why. Because I never thought I'd come back. So to me, getting to come back to the show on camera was a complete surprise, and so I kind of took it as a bonus, regardless of what it was. I thought they did a good job of linking my return to the original story and having it make some sense, because that's a big gap to fill. I thought that was cool. I'd be really hard pressed to complain about getting to come back to a show I hadn't been on in 7 years. It was a great experience to get to be back on that set and back working with those people. I've been directing, but it's not the same thing as being in front of the camera and playing with the performers in that regard. So, I mean, did I wish I didn't die? Sure, but I think we all wish we didn't die. It's just great to be back there and get to play ball a little bit. And like I said, it was such a complete surprise that to me it was all gravy. That was awesome.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you. And I get, like, you're talking more about storyline and that kind of thing, but I kind of think beyond that, just in terms of the opportunity was for me. It was just such a blessing.
Chuck is still alive.
Say it again?
Chuck is still alive.
Chuck is still alive.
Yeah, I didn't die. I'm just vacationing in heaven.
You.
He said he wasn't. Hi, I have a question for Matt.
Matt,
hey.
My mom and I watched General Hospital, and we really
want to
know when you're
going to
break up with Ava.
Oh, man. Why? Now we're getting to the core right now.
Why would you want to try to be a homewrecker? Why do you want to break up a happy home? It's the sinner and the saint. You have the serial murderer and the literal saint together. I mean, if it wasn't for Ava, I wouldn't be shirtless nearly as much on that show.
Yeah, what you got there, man? You know I'm going to be putting a shirt on.
It's not like I can do shirtless sex scenes by myself.
No, it's a real number when Matt's wearing a shirt. Nobody likes Matt when he's wearing a shirt. No point in watching Matt do anything if he's wearing a shirt. Have I said too much?
I'm pretty sure that you should watch the next couple of weeks because shit is gonna hit the fan.
What? I haven't filmed it yet, but I read the scripts for the week I go back, and boy, I am very uncomfortable facing... She is such a strong character, this woman, Maura West. She is like the iconic, villainous, beautiful, blue-eyed murderer on the show, and also the love of my life. And I had sex with her daughter, and she doesn't know about it yet. Her daughter's a young.
Oh my God, that's getting weird when you start getting to the show again.
Yeah, it's gonna be weird.
Wait, so your stepdaughter?
Wait, what? No, we're not like.
This is like, got all Woody Allen.
What kind of show is this?
Yeah. Ladies and gentlemen, General Hospital.
You weren't actually married to her.
Oh, no, we're not married. She's just, we're dating, and okay. She took me away from the church and turned me into her sex slave. And then,
if you gotta leave the church, you know what I mean?
Just another Tuesday.
If you're gonna be a slave.
Well, just another day in the daytime world. And then, you know, I got in an argument with her, so that naturally leads to screwing her daughter.
Sure.
Right. So, now what comes to
Robbie,
mind is coming.
Robbie, do yourself a favor. Don't get in an argument with Matt. As your father.
But, yeah. I'm trying to make
you can't even entertain that joke, okay? I just sucked as a serious warning.
No, I just can't wait to set my DVR to record General Hospital.
The shirtless shit hits the shirtless fan.
So I might be dead soon on General Hospital if Ava wants it that way.
No.
I'm not sure. We'll see.
Dr. Monroe.
Dr. Monroe.
Four more years.
Dr. Monroe. You on this side, question.
Okay, we heard a story from Jason Manns yesterday.
Oh, really?
About Rich and Rob were going to be replaced by him. And that Rich had a rather rough reaction to that news. Can you elaborate on your end of that story?
Okay, so what did Jason tell you?
He said that, he was getting praise for taking over your guys' spot one weekend when you couldn't do the con at all, either Rich and Rob. So he was Rich and Rob for the hosting.
Right, yeah.
And that he got lots of praise for doing a good job.
He did.
And that Jared set up for Creation to send him an email that they were going to replace you with Jason,
because
Jason was so much cheaper and he was just as good.
Right. Okay, so that's the right setup. Okay, so here's the big story. To really set the stage, you have to understand that I was in the middle of directing an episode. And I can only tell you from my...
Is it your first episode?
It was not, but nonetheless, it's just so much work when you're directing an episode. You're just buried the whole time. And so... Jared, we're going to lunch, and which is lunch is never lunch. You're always talking to the ADs and the DPs and getting ready for the next thing. But the guy's passed me like, "Hey, duck out without eating 5 minutes early. Come see us in the trailer." I'm like, "Okay." I went to the trailer, one of their trailers, and they're there and they're like, "So we got an email. We need you to look at it, we'll talk." So they hand me their phone with the email on it, and. It said it was from Stephanie, who was in on the joke.
Yeah.
Stephanie from Creation was in on the joke, because Jared made her send it. He wrote the email, but sent it as it was from her account. And it was this whole thing about, "You're so great, Jason." And Jason had forwarded it saying, "Guys, I don't know what to do." So like it was a very clever, well-executed, because they're evil people, and so they really did a good job. And so they read this thing, and it says, "We replace Rob and Rich for the remainder of the year." And I looked at it and I was like, huh. I sat there for a while, I'm like, Jason Mann's a good friend of mine, good friend of ours, good friend of everybody, I really love Jason Mann. So I'm sitting there going, "Well, it's positive for Jason." And I sat there and this is, you can ask Jared, this is literally, but the first thing I said, I go, "This is gonna kill Rob." I said, you can't even show Rob this. This is gonna kill him. It's gonna kill him. And they're like, "We know. We're over here." And they dragged this thing out, like, "So, how do we handle it?" They went down the rabbit hole, like, you know, do we call Creation? Do we step in? Do we put our foot down? I'm like, no, don't, you know, if this is the way the tides are blowing, then so be it. And, you know, it'll be a bummer, but. You know, I guess it's a changing of the guard is a good thing, but you can't tell Rob. He's gonna kill Rob. And then at some point, really, I mean, now I'm going, fuck, I got a ton of shit to shoot up because I just got fired. Like, oh man. And so I'm going out and they're like, "Okay, well, you know, let's circle back on this and we'll figure out what to plan, but just, you know, stew on this for a little bit. We're fucking with it." And I'm walking out the door like, "What?" And click over the door like, "Ha!" And Jerry, "Oh!" And they're like, "Yep, we're messing with you." And I did the only thing I knew to do, which was tackle Jensen to the floor. Because, whoa. But my inner locker room football player came out, I'm like, bleepy, bleepy. And then Jared goes, oh, damn it, I forgot to hit record. They were gonna film the thing. They were gonna film the whole thing. And I'm like, that's such a butthole move. Set me up. And did you get me and then film it? What was the game plan then? Project it before the panel? Like, what the? Here's her. We got a little her. I handled it well, because I'd be forever in trouble if I'd been like, you know what, F Jason Mans, man, I'm gonna fire him, I'm tired of this crap, I want my fingers to the bone. All I said was, don't tell him I was gonna kill him. But then, they tell me, we start laughing about the joke. We start laughing like oh man, that was hilarious, and they really got me. I was totally fooled. And we're laughing, and they're like, it's so funny, man. We thought you'd like flip out and have this emotional reaction. All you did is sit there and eventually go, don't tell Rob he's gonna kill him. And we start laughing like, hey, but you know what? If we tell Rob the story about the joke and he knows that I said, don't tell Rob to kill him, honestly, we can't tell him that either. That'll kill him.
So, meanwhile, I'm none the wiser. I wasn't there for any of this. And I think we go to a con. And they all sat me down to tell me the story as if it happened. But tell me, that, by the way, this is a joke. This didn't happen. They had to tell me gently the joke. Listen, this didn't happen. But there was a text that we made up.
I know.
You're not fired.
It was such an elaborate joke, and it worked so well. I literally am so grateful that I didn't blow my top and make a jerk of myself, because I would never live it down.
Well, I think it's so classic that you're, thank you so much. I think it's so classic that your response is like, we can't tell Benedict.
It's a crusher.
He already almost died once, he can't do it again.
Anyway, thank you for making me relive that nightmare. Hi.
My first con, and I caught the guitar at karaoke yesterday.
Yeah,
you threw your guitar?
I threw one of your guitars right off. She caught it one hand and put it in her backpack and it walked off. Really?
Thank you for not letting it break, and at some point I'm gonna need it back.
Yeah. Either that or a blank check for a new one.
That's adorable. So
I saw the video, you threw the guitar and she snagged it and you just said, don't tell Rob, it'll kill him.
Yeah, so my question is for the three of you, what was your reactions like meeting each other? Do you have like expectations to be like, he seems really nice, and then you got to know him and you're like, man, I was wrong.
I originally assumed I was going to be an asshole.
Yeah, but that's because he'd previously been an asshole. No, Robbie and I had met a couple times, and Rob never remembered meeting me, so I thought he was just kind of standoffish. It turns out he's not standoffish, but that was my initial opinion. And I didn't have a preconceived notion of Matt. We met on the circuit and got along immediately, and that's kind of was what it was.
Yeah, that's like more his take on the thing, you know? Like, we met on the circuit, and Rich was like, oh, hey, buddy, you're cool, let's be cool together, and then let's go to a meet and greet, buy all these drinks for all these people to meet and greet, and then, hey,
wow.
What's your room number, Matt? Don't worry, boom, and then I go to check out Sunday morning, just after meeting my great buddy Richard Spade for the first time, and I have a $375 hotel room charge, and I didn't eat a damn thing from room service,
but it was one of our best meet and greets.
It really was, it was really great. He still, to this day, has not paid me back.
I have, but I promise one day I won't. Yes.
Why don't we do that anymore? Why can't we buy drinks at our meet and greet?
Well,
good question.
I don't know.
Those were the days.
Those were the days.
I remember thinking that you and Richard were close, and, you know, I was looking forward to meeting you because you seemed like a cool guy, and you're a cool guy.
I was worried about you thinking that we were close. I thought, this is going to kill him. And I didn't even know you at the time. Going to kill the new guy.
One of these days, I'll be gone.
For like the first
one with more green.
Well, I'll say it, and it killed him.
That should kill him. Next question. Yeah, I was excited to meet both you. Richard I'd met already. He didn't remember that, but
Don't turn into a House of Lies, dude. I love your guys' story of the bar at the Arclight.
That's my favorite part of the story. Every time I go to the Arclight, I think of that story. That Richard and I had met a few times, and every time he was like, hey, you know, Richard's paid. I'm like, hey, man, how are you? And then other times he's like, hey, Richard's paid. I'm like, hey, man, how are you?
No, you don't be like, yeah, you know what? Haven't been a pleasure. Like, we actually, okay. a couple of times, next time I see him, Rob, Rich Bay, he's like, sure, I'll sign that for you. I'm like, no, I just, never mind.
Who do we make it out to? And then one time, as Rich tells it, he and his wife were out for a movie, to see a movie, and my wife and I were at the same movie theater, having a drink before the movie. He and his wife went up to the same bar to order a drink. The bartender says to Rich, hey, aren't you on Supernatural? Rich says, yeah, I am on Supernatural. And he's like, isn't that guy also on Supernatural? Rich is like, yeah, he is. He's like, why aren't you two talking? Rich is like, he never remembers me. So Rich didn't come up and say hi, because we didn't know each other really well. And I don't remember this because I didn't see him. I didn't, you know, I would have been like, hey, man.
Now you saw me, and were you looking at me, and you went, anyway, sweetie, the thing is. Anyway.
And then we finally met. The band was playing in Burbank at a convention. That was back in the day when we were just band with it. Like, once a year, we'd come to one convention, play just one concert. That's it. And Richard was so nice. He stayed and watched the band. And then afterwards, there's a picture of this online somewhere. Afterwards, Richard waited. Afterwards, we would sign autographs right after our show. So we're all at this table, band signing autographs. And Richard's waiting in line to say hello to us. And there's a picture of that Richard waiting in line to say hello to the band.
I've never met the band.
You guys, good show. And I said, who's it to?
And sing.
Thank you so much for being like amazing
hosts
this weekend. It's super special.
Thank you.
You.
Hi. This question's for all three of you. Which character type do you enjoy playing or watching the most? A good hero character with a little bit of a dark side, or an evil villain character with a little bit of light?
I don't know if I can pick one of those. I mean, it kind of depends on the project and who's playing the role. Really, if I'm watching something.
Villain. I mean, I'd say villain.
Your villain?
It's fun to play. It's fun to watch someone play a really good villain. I'm not really a villain, so it's fun to play that kind of. For me, I've never really played like a full-on villain, but I've played a lot of douchebags, and that's there's something freeing about that because I don't think that I'm a douchebag, but it's really fun to play one.
Nobody on set was wearing red pants, right? I just want to be sure. Red pants weren't involved.
You just pause. And I think it's fun to watch them play a good villain, you know. It's not easy to do. Anyway, that's my answer.
Ready? Yeah, I've got to play a villain a few times. I generally play kind of the shirtless douchebag, but when I do get to play the villain, that's really fun.
Yeah, her question for you is really, man, do you prefer being a shirtless villain or a shirtless nice guy?
Or like a shirtless guy in between.
Superhero with a dark punk edge.
All the characters are fun to play. I think our job is so damn fun to make believe and dress up and, hey, quiet down, little child. Acting like a baby. Stop acting like a baby. I'm talking about myself shirtless. Hey. All right. I think we all love our jobs, and acting is super fun, and playing villains and heroes and shirtless people is all pretty damn fun. It's all good. It's all great.
Thank you.
And that's my answer.
Love you all.
Love you back. This side.
Oh yeah, this side. There you go.
Hi, love you guys, first off. This is my first convention. My question is for all three. Seeing as you guys played two different sort of characters on the show, which one did you prefer and why? So like, you know, Chocolate Prophet.
Right, Chucker God.
Yeah.
Gabriel or the Trickster.
Yeah. John Winchester and Michael.
For me, Chuck. I love the whole concept that Chuck is God and embrace that. And it was super, certainly really fun to play the God part of Chuck, but I think because it started as Chuck for me, I'm partial to Chuck, and I think it's also great that even as God, you know, he's like, just call me Chuck, you know? And I like that part of him that's kind of like self-deprecating and like doesn't want too much attention. Yeah. When you find out he's God, that's kind of annoying as a viewer because you're like, step up to the plate, God. Let you guys wreck this on your own. You know, and certainly it's fun to make believe that I'm the father of these two guys and hold that over them.
He does.
But I'd say, I guess, Chuck. Guys?
You think, since theoretically, I've only played Loki once, and that was this past season, I gotta go with Gabriel, because I've done much more with that character. Although getting to do that work as Loki and trying to figure out what that character looks and feels like and sounds like in the Supernatural universe was just a ton of fun. So, I mean, I'd say it's a tie, except for the fact that I've played Gabriel so many more times, it'll go with Gabriel, but I sure enjoy, you know, figuring out who the Loki guy is, and I think I'm dead, but fingers crossed, if they ever came up with a way to have Loki come back, it would be fun to keep exploring that guy, because it was cool. I'm again, torn. I think both characters are tremendous. Obviously, playing, you know, John is such a huge deal. I mean, more for me, there'd be no show, basically. Also, I really like being Michael because there's no rules, you know? It's just, you're kind of a whatever, however you want to play it type of guy. And then, you know, he doesn't really die, so he can, like, come back anytime he wants. Where John's stuck in 70s with a comb-over. Unless I get a spin-off at some point, and then we tell the tale of the comb-over. They're both great. Playing two characters is a gift on television, especially when they're well-written, like Supernatural, and well-supported by this fandom. It's just a blast to play.
He's too serious.
What?
Michael's too serious, like, face-wise, at least, like, with John Winchester, he, like...
I didn't hear what you said. You said John's too serious?
No, Michael is, so I feel like John...
Well, thank you for that critique of my character. I'll take that. Thank you for your question. This side. Hi there.
Hi.
I can't see you, but I know somebody's standing there looking at me on a microphone.
My name is Alana.
Hi, Alana.
Hi. And this question is for Rob.
Okay.
All right.
Clock in.
Hi. I'm sorry. I'm so nervous.
It's okay. Me too.
It's okay. Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
Oh, look at you. You're me.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Thank you. And I wanted to know, if God Chuck is ever gonna get done with his vacation with his sister and come see what Sam is.
Yeah.
Yeah. Believe me. Yes. I'm dying to come back and straighten
He's super cute.
Things out. Yeah. That's all. Yeah. Believe me. I really want to come back and I feel like I'm almost done with Amara. Like, she's a lot of work. But I'm almost done with the sort of vacation sibling bonding going on. And I'm ready to come back. I feel like I need to come back. I feel like things need to be straightened out. Do my yearly straightening out and then head off again. So yeah, fingers crossed, I'll be back at some point and I can try to fix some stuff. Which makes more people mad at me. Because people like to be mad at me. But yeah.
We're all secretly hoping for the episode where we get to be in it together, really.
Yeah.
That's of our hearts.
That's what I would like.
The dad and son's episode.
Me and my boys.
Thank you, love you.
Thank you, love you too.
Hi.
Hi, guys. My question's for Rich. My son wants to know, on French Mistake, there's a guy that dodges bullets after Virgil's shooting up the set, and he wanted to know if that had anything to do with Gabriel, or...
I got real lost here. Say it again?
On French Mistake, there's a guy that dodges bullets when the Virgil's shooting up the set.
Serge is shooting up the set in the French Mistake. Who's Serge? Virgil is shooting up the set. I've seen this episode. I don't know who Virgil is.
He's the angel that came to our reality to chase.
Okay, and he's doing what?
He killed Bobby Singer.
Okay.
And while he's shooting, there's a guy that dodges bullets. He's supposed to be in our reality, but yet he dodges two bullets.
Okay.
So my son thought it had something to do with Gabriel because he looks similar to you at the time.
Let's go with sure.
But are you made a French mistake, uncredited, as a bullet dodger?
As a person bullet dodging.
Yeah.
I'm going to go with yes.
Oh.
Because people love that episode. The true answer is I have no idea. I'm not even exactly sure what you're talking about, but I'm going to go with yes, because I don't want to disappoint the children. Thank you. All right. You there. You're welcome.
My mom made the mistake of letting me watch the show when it started, so I'm very anxious to be here. I was 5 when it started.
It's a great show for 5-year-olds. I sometimes think, what's going to get my kids to sleep? But you know what? You know, nothing puts your 5-year-old down like a demon going, face. Or your mom on fire at the ceiling.
Yeah, that's really.
It's amazing. I never gave an address, ever, never. But since I've been watching the show for a while, obviously I have favorite episodes, it's hard to pick one. If you had to pick your favorite episode, either that you watched or that you started, what would it be?
Baby. Mainly because I'm in it, and also because I like the car a lot. I think there's two. I said this, several different conventions that Supernatural at moments in every season is, it's a great show, and every now and then it's a beyond great show. It can have moments of being on par with anything you like on cable. It has moments of just pure brilliance, which is impressive. After this many years, this many seasons, this many storylines, and you can still do that. For me, still one of my favorite episodes is Swan Song. I just think it's so. I think that's one of those episodes where if you didn't know the show and you turned it on, you'd be like, holy mackerel. I mean, just the way they mixed media from the 16mm stuff in the car, the narration that was like the deity telling the story of these boys and the journey you witnessed of their childhood and their bonding to them being adults and the trauma they're going through. I thought it was just...
And being Eric Christie's final episode.
Yeah. It's a stunning episode of TV.
Yeah.
Who directed that?
Eric.
Kripke directed it.
Yeah, oh, yeah,
very impressive.
Boy, yeah, I agree. Both of those are great episodes. French Mistake is an amazing
episode. That's a great one.
Yeah.
That virtual guy. I mean...
And the uncredited Richard Spade.
Yeah, well.
Shh. Being selfish, one of my favorite episodes that I have the honor of being in is Don't Call Me Shirley. I thought it was a piece of television. Because Robert Thompson, who's all of one of our favorite writers, wrote that. And it's, they don't normally on network television allow people to have lengthy talking scenes like that. I mean, the bits between me and Curtis were such, it was like a one-act play. It's such lengthy scenes, two characters having dialogue, and I just thought it was really well done.
You know, another episode that you were in that's fantastic is the 200. Yeah. Not mentioned by a lot of people as like a favorite,
awesome.
But that musical and the technical aspect of making that musical work. And another thing, I've been blessed by getting to direct the show, and I have been able to study at the feet of some of the most talented TV directors I have ever worked with, and I'm not just saying that to blow smoke, truly, and that was written by Phil Segrisha, who's an executive producer on the show, and has directed some episodes that to me are stunning. Another great episode, Song Remains the Same, Tim Robinson, Jensen Ackles fighting in the barn. Is an unbelievable fight sequence. Again, a Phil Segrisha episode. There's just some great... Yeah, the show's good, guys. It's a good show. I hope it
really liked it. Changing Channels. That was such a good
episode. That was very good. Man named Charles Beeson, who still directs for Kripke all the time. He just goes to Kripke, and he was on Revolution, and now he's on the new one. He was on Supernatural, and then kind of moved on when Kripke moved on. But he was on for years, a lovely guy. That's obviously another really good,
great episode.
Solid episode. Anyway, thank you for the question. Your essay. Thank you. You.
Hi. So, if Chopper were to come back like right now, what do you think his reaction would be to Gabriel being tortured and kidnapped, and Lucifer being dead?
Wow, you gotta run the whole gamut of emotions. Nonplussed, and nonplussed, I guess that's...
Listen.
I'm just saying, you could have saved me earlier, but you decided not to, so that question brings into question your parenting, but whatever. Hey, go ahead, ask the question. You be you.
It's hard when someone's in for eternity in their awkward teen years. I hated seeing Gabriel tortured like that. That was rough to watch. I was a little bit secretly okay with his mouth being sewn shut. That was for this reason, because of the snarky snark.
Okay. Didn't want to do a strong talking to and go right to the sew the lip shut. Pretty extreme parenting.
I'm an extreme person. That I'll give you. I'm God, for God's sake. I'm God for me's sake. I did not see that. And, you know, I am of the opinion that maybe Lucifer, who knows? I mean, I'm not going to call him dead. But if I came back right now and they said, no, by the way, Lucifer's dead, Gabriel was alive and now he's dead again, I'd be extremely angry. Those are my sons. They're very strong beings, and in my mind, they're never quite dead. So I'd be like, right, back it up. Let's straighten this out. And I would get all my sons back together again, and we'd all have a sit-down Thanksgiving-style dinner and just hash it out. That's what I'd do.
Like you did the Godfather. That's right. Good one, the Godfather. Thank you for the question. You know.
Back in time and meet with your younger version who was about to audition, what would you tell them?
Ooh.
Hold on to your hat. You're in for quite a ride. I think none of us thought it would be anything more than one episode. So that's all I was focused on at the time.
I would go back and say in 2013, don't go with the cheerleading outfit for the karaoke theme. You will regret it. Matthew?
I would like to second Richard's advice on the karaoke theme thing.
We've made some mistakes.
Just don't pick out the cheerleading outfit for the karaoke theme because your new partner in crime is going to sacrifice his and make you wear yours all year long. You wore it once.
Yeah, but
did you even wear it once?
Nobody wants to see. You're like a Ken doll. I'm like Mr. Potato Head.
I go to my 2014 self and say, listen, Richard's going to be so upset he had to wear a cheerleading outfit, he's going to make you dress like Khaleesi for a year. Just say no.
Rob pissed and moaned about that costume every Friday night as he stood like this and got sewn into it.
Yeah.
Like, man could have walked away, could have lowered his arms and taken out the dragon and called it, like, I am so mad at you. Tighter.
You know what? In defense of Robbie, I was invited to the Spade family household for a Halloween that same year that Rich sacrifices beautiful cheerleading outfit, and what do I see to my surprise? Not only the beautiful American Richard Spade family along with a nice bowl of American Frito pie, but there's Mr. Spade walking through his neighborhood in the cheerleading outfit.
That's true. Well, that was for the kids.
Yeah. Nothing says kids like Richard Spade in a miniskirt.
It was the scariest Halloween ever. Thank you for the question. Yeah.
I just want to start off by saying I love you guys just so much, and karaoke last night made my entire weekend.
Awesome. Matthew?
My question was for Rob and Richard. Do you think that when your characters were first introduced, that the writers had any idea that you were going to be God and the trickster was going to be Gabriel?
I feel comfortable saying no, that the writers didn't have that in mind for my character. I think it was a one-off, that they realized they could do something interesting with in the mythology of the show they were creating. Because they waited, you know, like a year before bringing him back. It wasn't like it sparked something and they continued to use him. I did an episode, didn't hear from anybody for another season. So I think it was a happy accident, if you will. Robbie?
I mean, I would love to ask Eric Kripke the question, because he knew by the end of season five, after Swan Song, he, you know, told me that was his idea, that I was God. But I don't know if from the beginning, probably not. He probably evolved as my character sort of grew a little bit. And they explored, you know, the whole idea of me being the creator because I was the writer of the show. And I always thought I was an embodiment of Eric Kripke, sort of being the creator of the universe. So, what I did probably came here was my character evolved. That's my guess. But I knew at the end of season five, the whole God thing. I was just happy to finally come out of the closet with it in season 12.
Thank you for your question.
Thank you.
Here.
Hi, my question's for Rob.
Robbie!
Yeah.
So your band name is Loud and Swing.
Correct.
Oh, that's funny you should say that.
Here they are.
As they take the stage.
My question is, so first part of the loud in is loud, which is opposite of quiet.
Yes.
Loud and, so how would you define swing as a way to describe your sound? So loud and what?
Well, Billy's doing it right there, Robbie. He's answering for you.
This is your swing.
That's the swing.
That's the swing. It's like swaying.
Now, you got to keep in mind that Billy is on acid right now, so he didn't hear your question and doesn't care who you are.
The whole thing came out of an acid trip that Billy was having.
Yeah.
ironically, he wasn't with the band when we needed the band, like we knew. But you know, the name of the band comes from this character that Matthew Modine played in Vision Quest. But yes, that is something I'm constantly dealing with when people say, what's your band name? They say Loud and Sway, and they're like, Loud and, I'm like, no, Loudon, like Loud and, okay. Anyway, but yeah, it's the acid trip. It all comes back to Billy and his drug problem.
Robbie, here's a question for you.
Yeah.
I know the band Fabulous Musicians out of Los Angeles, California, tonight.
Yeah.
Shit show, or are you going to put on a good one? What's going to happen? Are we phoning it in, or are you guys some surprises up your sleeve? What's going on tonight?
We're
going
to have a great show. There are so many actors here that sing. We're playing some new songs. We're playing some old classics. Yeah, but we're working hard on it. It's an amazing set list tonight.
Well, I'll tell you.
9 o'clock.
I heard from you fellows who were here yesterday that we have a lot of new people in the house.
Yes,
we
do.
A lot of new people in the house. Well, if you have not been to a Saturday Night Special, do not make the mistake of missing it tonight. This band does a great favor to this convention by standing here and backing us all up. But in truth, they are performers of the highest caliber, and tonight they slide from here to there to put on their own show, and it's the best thing we do all weekend. Please, come take part in the Saturday Night Special. Let's go! Again, sometimes there are panels, sometimes there are photos, and sometimes there are games. Games with multiple answers. The answers could be anything. But in this case,
two answers.
We've just limited it to two simple answers. It's either yes or it's no. Bobby?